Hi, Andres. Thanks for joining me today, friend.
Thank you for having me. How do I pronounce your name? Tasshin?
Oh, that'll work just fine. Yeah, that's how most people pronounce it. In Japanese, it's Tasshin, but almost everyone says Tashin, so including me. Yes.
Excellent.
Yes. Yeah, so we've sort of skirted around each other on Twitter for a while, and I've been aware of QRI for a while as well, but really only peripherally. So that's what I'm excited to dive into is learning more about you and your work and what you're up to, and kind of from ground zero, just being sort of aware peripherally. And there's a lot to talk about. So, but I would love to hear just to start from you about your own life story and your background and where you're coming from and anything you'd like to share about that.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, no, this is great. Thank you for having me. So, life story. Yeah, I mean, I would definitely define myself as somebody who suffers from hyperphilosophia, which means basically compulsively thinking about the nature of reality and being, yeah, very distracted by that and the big questions. So yeah, but definitely kind of like since I was like a small child, just like asking those questions and trying to find answers. Yeah, I mean, I guess like a random anecdote is I think like my mom likes to share that like when I was 3 years old, I asked her like, where does the heat of a cup of coffee go when it cools down? And like, I guess I mean that a lot of kids ask questions like that, but I think I was particularly insistent on trying to find answers, which turned out fairly well because my grandfather had a background in physics and math and oceanography, so like we used to have like a lot of discussions about that. And and I think like for the most part in childhood I was very determined to have kind of like a career on like math or physics, thinking like that's the main way to figure out the nature of reality. But then yeah, I guess like roughly around like the age of 16 or so, kind of like realized that consciousness is as big of a mystery as yeah, the nature of reality. And yeah, kind of had a lot of these thoughts of like there's really kind of like two huge blockages for understanding like why are we here? The first one is why is there something rather than nothing? And then the second one is what is consciousness and how does it arise? And exactly, you know, what are the conditions for its existence? And I yeah, basically figured that I mean, there's a lot of like super smart people trying to figure out the first one, but not that many trying to figure out the second one, at least not with kind of like the ambition of actually getting answers. So I shifted my focus to consciousness from the age of 16, read everything I could. I mean, people like David Chalmers and Daniel Dennett. I was, yeah, very dissatisfied with the kind of answers that they provided, although, yeah. Basically, understood there was like something to their work for sure. I got a little bit into meditation maybe around like 17. Like I had the luck of talking to a ex-Buddhist Zen monk at my high school. I went to this what's called a United World College, like one of those yeah kind of international schools. All over the world. The one I attended to was in Norway, and yeah, one of the volunteers, a permanent residence there, was a Zen monk for like 14 years. So yeah, I had the luck of him like teaching some meditation courses and exploring that a little bit. Had some interesting experiences that yeah, definitely made me question the nature of personal identity and the self. Had a one experience in particular of like ego dissolution that made me yeah basically kind of reorient kind of sense of identity towards consciousness more generally as opposed to yeah just my life story or individual. And definitely since then it's been a process of integrating that information and making sense of that. But I think like unlike I guess like just you know a phenomenological perspective, I've gone at it in a very kind of hardcore philosophical fashion. And by now, I think I've built kind of like a repertoire of like arguments and perspectives that I think actually kind of like push the boundary a little bit relative to like where the conversation is at in academic philosophy. So, I mean, if people are familiar with this kind of like Derek Parfit and definitely people in utilitarianism and so on, I would say like I have definitely think, you know, elements to add to that conversation that are non-trivial, meaningful, and significant. And then another very big update definitely was meeting David Pierce. So like, I went to Stanford for undergraduate and my master's. And there also I went, you know, kind of expecting like, well, I'm gonna find a lot of people who are like very philosophical and into the nature of reality, and just completely disappointed that like in my dorm, like nobody was interested in those conversations, or if they were, like it was very superficial, you know, kind of like very little drive to really answer those questions. But the place where I found like people were interested in that was not even in the philosophy department. It was more in the cognitive science and kind of neuroscience side, which at Stanford is this major called symbolic systems. And there I met a good number of people interested in these subjects, had great conversations, met with professors, and then with a group of people in that cluster decided to found the Stanford Transhumanist Association. Yeah, basically this must be like, yeah, 2010, 2011, kind of like the beginning of the emerging cluster of, I guess, like rationalism and effective altruism, and the tail end of, I guess, like transhumanism and extropianism. So yeah, I had the good fortune of like, given that template, to be able to invite, yeah, really cool people like, you know, Aubrey de Grey, people from, you know, the Singularity Institute back then, and, you know, transhumanist philosophers like David Pierce. Like we flew him over to Stanford. He gave a presentation, and talking to him, actually, I made some really major updates to my worldview. Whereas like before, like, I mean, I had read his stuff, but like it was really talking to him in person that like did most of the work. Where like basically my philosophy beforehand was like, okay, let's write the absolutely most compelling case for like why we're all one consciousness, so that we can like essentially create a blissful, you know, civilization and so on. But then after talking to him, I realized like, hey, philosophy is actually not going to fix things like chronic pain and or factory farming, a lot of these problems, for which we actually need like much more pragmatic solutions. So I sort of like made a kind of twin track of like, okay, yes, personal identity is really important, but then also we need to actually look at the neurobiology of suffering and like address that directly. And like, yeah, kind of like being very skeptical that philosophy alone would actually do that. So then I guess like towards the end of my undergraduate degree, I met Mike Johnson, with whom then I co-founded the Qualia Research Institute. The big piece of insight from him was this idea that valence is probably the proper way in which to analyze valence, the proper level of abstraction is not neurotransmitters or kind of like low level neurobiology, but actually much more at the level of like the structural features of experience. And I mean, that's a huge rabbit hole and very happy to talk about it, but just like kind of understanding that and then like having some insights into that made me realize that, yeah, this is essentially the start of a completely new field. And there's huge areas of neglected phenomenology that inform this kind of vision. And I guess, yeah, for the last like 5 years or so, I've been kind of like, yeah, working at startups at several companies while continuing to develop the philosophy and the research. And then about 3 years ago, decided to stop working and just see if I can actually just dedicate full time to research consciousness and make it happen. And so far, it's going pretty well. I mean, ups and downs, but I would say the trajectory is like really promising.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, could you say a little bit more about what that shift is? I'm not sure I fully understood in terms of like looking things in terms of valence and what that means exactly.
Yeah, so basically, if you ask like what is suffering and what is happiness to different people, you will have like very different responses, right? Like I guess if you ask a Buddhist, is gonna be, depends on the tradition, but like it will be something along the lines of like, well, the source of, you know, suffering is clinging and an attachment or something of that nature. If you ask an AI researcher, they will say, you know, suffering is inevitable in any reinforcement learning agent or something like that. The level of explanation is going to be at the algorithmic level of analysis. if you ask a neurobiologist, they might say, like, well, you know, like it's dynorphin or, you know, substance P, or like, you know, these particular neurotransmitters that induce pain. Or, you know, if you ask like a social scientist, they might say something like, well, it's cognitive algorithms that have to do with your expectations of reproduction or survival or social inclusion and things like that. And that's like all of those like are important lenses. I would say they are like pieces of the puzzle, but they're actually not pointing directly at what suffering is like fundamentally. So to make that like leap, you have to, I mean, there's like a lot of kind of background to like deeply grasp it. And I mean, maybe over the course of the conversation we'll get there. But basically you have to look at individual moments of experience and then trying to identify what is it about those moments of experience that constitutes like dukkha, that constitutes joy. Essentially we have assembled a wide range of evidence that suggests that it's actually the structure of the experience that determines what its valence is, how good or bad it feels. I mean, and to a first approximation, I'll just put it out there and we can unpack it. We have found that suffering is accounted for by dissonance in experience. Happiness and pleasure is accounted for by consonance. And neutral feelings are accounted for by noise components. So, you know, there's a lot of different kinds of pleasures, there's a lot of different kinds of pains. And so a lot of people may, let's say classical functionalism in philosophy of mind, they might say something like, well, there is no such thing as a suffering, is a collection of algorithms, is a improper reification. But you could say the same about, like, for example, dissonance in sound if you don't pay close attention, right? Like you can say, well, there is trumpet dissonance, there's piano dissonance, you know, there's like screeching sounds. Like, what do they all have in common? They're like a weird family, a grab bag. But then if you actually look at the waveform of sound and you run algorithms, it comes down to like dissonance essentially is an actual shared mathematical pattern across the spectrum, which is intimately related with these things that are called beat patterns. If you add like 400 hertz and 420 hertz, very close frequencies, they generate like large beat patterns. They generate this roughness in sound. So even though there are many kinds of dissonance in a way, they all share that property. And so you can actually come up with a total dissonance score in sound that will tell you how unpleasant, how aversive that sound is. So my claim is that in the case of sound, like that we know that, we can condense these like very nebulous, you know, property into this very precise mathematical structure. And our claim is that you can do the same for every sense modality, including like thoughts and emotions and feelings, that there is this construct of dissonance that essentially is there. No matter where in the body or in the mind suffering is located, you will find it. And at the limit, I mean, there's also some important extrapolations to make here, but at the limit, this comes down to what we believe is symmetry. So essentially, very blissful states of consciousness are states of consciousness where there's a lot of energy organized in a highly symmetrical structure. Whereas very unpleasant states of consciousness are energy that is organized in incongruent or competing symmetrical structures. Whereas neutral feelings would be just the absence of symmetry, what is called asymmetry. So anyway, I said a bunch, so curious about your reaction.
So there's sort of structural features to widely different experiences that could be constituted as suffering, and if you investigate them structurally, then you'll understand them better and might be able to resolve them sort of categorically. And that's that, would you say that's, am I understanding correctly that that's sort of the like one of the sort of fundamental principles of the work that you all are doing at Qualia Research Institute is this sort of lens on things?
Yeah, I would say that's a very strong generator. I'll say two things. Like one of them is like the current leading hypothesis, it's the symmetry theory of valence, like specifically on like, yeah, everything comes down to symmetry. It may turn out that that's just adjacent and like it's kind of correlated with valence. So we're not kind of like married to the symmetry theory of valence, call it STV. The thing that is kind of the broader set to which we are married is, first of all, qualia formalism is this idea that for any given experience, there is a mathematical object such that the mathematical features of that object are isomorphic to the phenomenology. So that is kind of like a bet that essentially we're making a bet that consciousness is going to look much more like electromagnetism, where people used to wonder, well, there's like electricity and lightning and magnets, and is there really anything that ties them all together? Yes, Maxwell's equations like explain all of that. So as opposed to, for example, potentially something like life, which people used to think there is like, the essence of life, élan vital, the substance of life, but so far it doesn't seem to be the case. Like there's molecular complexity and more molecular complexity. There's no thing that is life itself. Although I'm sure that's maybe contentious in some in some circles, but yeah, basically we're making the bet that consciousness is like electromagnetism, essentially has a rich mathematical structure. And then within that like set, there is a slightly finer distinction, which is valence structuralism, which is the idea that what makes an experience feel good or bad is the structure of that experience. Now, it may not be symmetry, it may be something else, but I do essentially, yeah, put a lot of stock in that it's the structure of experience what matters, not,
Not
for
like the
example,
content.
not the content or what the experience is doing. Like it's doesn't matter if this is reinforcing or like involved with learning or anything like that. All of that is secondary. Like it's the structure what matters.
I imagine that this is something that's very obvious to you, but as you say, sort of in some circles that I might be in, this wouldn't be obvious. So what would you say the advantages are of formally mathematically describing some of these things?
Yeah, I mean the classical analogy, it's like if you ask Maxwell back in the day, like what are the advantages of coming up with these equations? Like are they even real, right? Like are they an improper reification? Well, if you look at an iPhone, it's like nothing in an iPhone makes sense except in the light of Maxwell's equations. Like the screen, the wires, the transistors, like basically that's like applied Maxwell's equations in a super hardcore way, and that's just the beginning of technology, right? Like I'm sure we're gonna get way crazier things in the future. Well, it's the same with consciousness. Like what is the use of formalizing consciousness, similar to like how there used to be like people were very impressed with like a light bulb and now we have iPhones. People are very impressed with like I don't know the jhanas or something. Like wait for what's going to happen in the future when we formalize consciousness.
Okay. Yeah, that I see what you mean. And would you say what is the kind of work that you all are doing at Qualia Research Institute? Is it primary philosophical? Is it experimental research? Is it something in between? Is it something different? How would you describe it?
Yeah, so I mean we're obviously tremendously ambitious, and I think like that's kind of necessary for the work that we do. And we have put out just so much work on many different kind of subcomponents of the field. Like at the highest level, you could actually say that what we're doing is field building. Like we are essentially constructing a new paradigm for how to look at consciousness that is new and different, relatively exotic. And in that sense, there's just like a lot to do. There's like so much low-hanging fruit. So but I can catalog, okay, like what is the rough shape of the things that we're doing? And I'll give you a 3x3 matrix. So first of all, I don't know, the horizontals, which are we're doing philosophy of mind, like straight up, like joining in the conversation with David Chalmers and Daniel Dennett, and okay, like, hey, we can actually say something meaningful that hasn't been said here and here and here. Maybe very arrogant, like a lot of people would say, like, well, you can only contribute to the conversation if you have a PhD in philosophy or something like that. But yeah, I mean, like people like we'll have to look at our work and judge if we're actually contributing or not. But so yeah, actual philosophy of mind, like core philosophy of mind, and that is philosophy. Then we also do actual neuroscience, like legitimate, like looking at fMRI, EEG, with novel paradigms for how to analyze it. Like one very important piece of our research is there's this work by Selin Atasoy. She used to be at Oxford when she developed this paradigm called connectome-specific harmonic wave decomposition. It's a completely new way of looking at the brain that analyzes it in terms of its resonant modes, similar to how you may analyze like a physical system. If you hit it and you hear the sound of it, you know, the sound will correspond to the ways in which it vibrates. Likewise, this technique decomposes brain activity in terms of its resonant modes. It's a controversial technique, and it may be fundamentally flawed. I could go into that. But we're very, we basically think that something like that, if not it, will shed a lot of light on consciousness. And basically, yeah, I mean, we have like essentially forked that paradigm, like coded it up, and we're collaborating with, yeah, other research groups to analyze like EEGs and fMRI of exotic states of consciousness, like the jhanas, like MDMA, and so on. So we've been neuroscience. And then we also have like a whole wing of neurotechnology, basically applying these insights and ideas into developing technology that hopefully will improve people's lives in a very radical way. Okay, so those are the horizontals. Then you have the verticals, which is like, what is the application? What is the purpose? And again, like a completely different view, this would be, okay, like we are actually trying to, you know, very hardcore, let's do a dent in reducing suffering in the world. I mean, this is kind of the effective altruist kind of perspective, except that we go at it from the point of view of consciousness realism and like taking suffering seriously as a mathematical thing, not just, you know, subjective self-reports or not just, well, there's a lot of kind of like suffering deflationism in consciousness, like in EA circles, in rationalist circles. People don't generally believe that you can quantify suffering or that it's meaningful to say that suffering has a actual quantity or that there's like something like that. We are essentially the only people in EA who are like, no, like suffering will come down to something like physical units. Like there's going to be like a, yeah, basically something like the watts equivalent for suffering. And that's like essential if you want to minimize it. I mean, how can you minimize something without like quantifying it in a meaningful way? With that lens, essentially, we break it out into essentially the following, which is the first column is let's get rid of intense suffering, because intense suffering is a lot worse than people realize intuitively. People have no idea just how bad intense suffering is. And based on our research, it's really bad. Like it's extraordinarily bad. So if you do a utilitarian calculation, it turns out that, yeah, probably getting rid of like the top causes of intense suffering would, you know, get rid of like 80% of the suffering in the world. Like it's a massive, massive thing. The second one is like improve baseline. What are like techniques and methods in order to improve like the everyday life of people. Even if you only care about intense suffering, that research still matters, right? Because you still need researchers to care about intense suffering. And, you know, traditionally negative utilitarians get really depressed and like ineffective. So actually increasing baseline still matters a lot, even if you have a suffering focused perspective. And the third column is achieving new heights of well-being, which, I mean, personally, and also from talking to people, it's a really motivating factor. I mean, if we could have like something like non-neurotoxic, hangover-free MDMA, like once a week, like that would be a game changer. Like I would be very motivated to get up in the morning and do work because I know like, hey, on Friday, I'm gonna have this, you know, amazing time with my friends and colleagues and family and so on. So those are kind of like the three columns. And yeah, I'm happy to, you know, go into any of the cells of these three by three or dive deeper into any of them. But roughly speaking, that is what we're doing at QRI.
Mm-hmm. So philosophy of mind, neuroscientific research, applied neuroscience, and then reducing suffering, improving baseline, and elevating the, like, what's possible, essentially.
Peak experiences.
Experiences, yes. Okay, gotcha. And what has your research focused on, or your work with Qualia Research Institute? Like, what have you been specifically focusing on?
Yeah, I mean, I'm one of the co-founders and mm-hmm. the director of research. So kind of everything.
Sure.
I mean, I could list projects I've worked on this year and...
Yeah, please.
Yeah, sure. So for ease of memory, I'll go from most recent to, to later.
Great.
So right now, I'm working on a very technical piece on solving the phenomenal binding problem, which is a classic problem in philosophy of mind. Essentially, we think we have a potential solution to it, overlooked in the literature. Again, sorry for sounding so arrogant. It's just, yeah, I mean, I'm looking at, like, okay, the work of David Chalmers and so on. It's like, yeah, I think our solution actually tackles the problems. For those who are curious about it, I already kind of presented it in my latest YouTube video, which is like an hour and 20 minute long and fairly technical, but it gives the answer. So for those who are curious.
Okay.
But I'm essentially putting that in a technical write-up to publish it. So that's like the latest thing I've done. Then since then, another very big project, still not done, but maybe like 70% done, is essentially also we think we may be able to solve the problem of kidney stones, which is like one of the massive sources of intense suffering. I mean, people reliably discuss kidney stones as like 10 out of 10 pain or 11 out of 10 pain, the worst suffering in their life. 1 in 10 people get them. How many kidney stones you have per person follows a long tail. Like some poor people who are still, you know, a stone once every 2 weeks for all of their life. Like it's a big problem. And essentially, we think we have like strong evidence to suggest that there is actually a way to prevent them. That is not what they suggest in medicine, which is let me see if I have it around. I could get it, but basically it's a supplement that is called chanca piedra, which is a herb from Latin America that basically the few studies that exist about it show that it's like just as effective as the best current treatments in medicine. And if you essentially what we are doing, I mean, this is kind of a I would say a little bit like I'm sure it's gonna get like a lot of like initial skepticism about the epistemology here, but then I think I can actually break down why the skepticism is unfounded given what we have found, which is that if you look at Amazon reviews and WebMed reviews of this supplement, you will find that the reviews are like really high quality. And I mean, I have like very vast experience analyzing engagement surveys and performance reviews. That used to be my day job back in the day. So I can tell whether something is like astroturfing, whether people are getting paid to write reviews. This is not it. These reviews are like 99.9% likely to be like actually completely genuine.
Is it a preventative or it's like if you do have it, it solves it, or both or other?
So that's the exciting thing. It works acutely in a number of ways. It reduces pain. It accelerates how fast it goes. How reduces the pain in which you expel them. But what we have found is that pretty much everybody in these reviews who says, "Oh, and by the way, I started taking them as a prophylactic," they say it works. That they just don't get kidney stones anymore. Like I think I've encountered one out of like 200 reviews that say they use it as prophylactic that say it didn't work. So, and there's like good physiological reasons to expect that it will actually work much better as a prophylactic. Maybe just a fun tidbit. It's basically kidney stones. They need a nucleation point, what's called a Randall's plug. It's like a tiny region of the kidney that you start growing a plaque in there. And once that gets started, then that forms as kind of the nucleation factor for kidney stones. And if you think about it, if you have like a substance that comes in and dissolves like the layer of the surface of the kidney stone every time you take the substance, well, what percentage of it you're going to be getting rid of essentially will be a function of this ratio of like what is the surface area relative to the volume. So actually, the larger the kidney stone is, the smaller the percentage of it you're going to be getting rid of with each time you take Shankapiedra. So by the time you have dissolved most of it, getting rid of the nucleation point is just very easy. It's just going to be a few treatments. So, and once you don't have the nucleation point, it's going to take a long while for it to form again. Like, you know, you need something to kickstart it. So the thought is that if you take this, you know, once a week, or maybe like you take it for a week every once a year or something like that, it will blast away that nucleation point. And then it's just not going to have like soil to grow. So that's why we suspect it's just so much more effective as a prophylactic than as an acute treatment. So the vision is to, and these are like dirt cheap. I mean, we're talking about like a treatment that's going to cost like $2 or $3 a year at most at scale. So we're talking about like, yeah, potentially preventing, you know, 90, 95% of kidney stones for like dirt cheap for everybody. So so that's like the project I've been working on. Also, we wrote an important essay explaining why functionalism has, well, a new argument for why functionalism doesn't work. I've been also analyzing EEG and fMRI data, or like I did that mostly at the beginning of the year, then passed on the project to somebody else. Wrote quite a few articles about valence and meditation. Had some interviews with some advanced meditators, and then developed further the theory of neural annealing, basically how to heal trauma with exotic states of consciousness. I think like an important thing from this year was kind of like figuring out what is the difference between DMT and 5-MeO-DMT. That's another big topic. I think we have like some meaningful things to say about. So I also have a video and a write-up about it. And then like, I would say like field building. It's kind of like laying out like, okay, what is there to be done? And why is neuroscience and efforts to reduce suffering really missing the target? A very big topic I wrote about early this year and quite a bit last year, and I will probably do a big project on next year, is this whole topic of anti-tolerance drugs. Basically, most people in pharmacology, most neuroscientists, when you ask them like, can somebody take like a you know, an opioid or something like that without developing tolerance, they'll say no, right? Like they'll say like what goes up has to come down. I don't know. There's a lot of explanations of that sort. But they're like intuitive models that actually don't follow like what the true data says. Actually, data suggests that tolerance has a very strange relationship to dose and to subjective effects. So essentially, there's like this class of drugs not talked about in the literature as a class. I mean, even framing it as a class is something that, to my knowledge, is QRI's work, which we call anti-tolerance drugs. Essentially, a class of drugs that if you take in conjunction with a euphoric or pain reliever, prevents the development of tolerance. And in some extreme cases, it even reverses tolerance. We have the case of ibogaine that, you know, is touted as kind of an amazing treatment for opioid addiction or, you know, hardcore heroin addicts. But the way in which that's usually framed is like, well, you take a huge dose, then have this introspective experience where you realize how bad of a person you've been or something like that, change your life. grow as a person, whatever. That's like one frame for like analyzing that experience. But what people don't necessarily emphasize is that like besides the psychedelic experience, there is also like direct physiological reversal of tolerance, where like all of a sudden after the experience, not only you don't have cravings for heroin, you just don't need it. You don't go into withdrawal. Now, what we do have also a lot of anecdotal data for, completely untouched by the literature as far as we know, is that microdosing ibogaine for example, chronic pain patients allows them to dramatically reduce the dose that they take of opioids without compromising the pain relief, and actually enhances the pain relief, and they feel way better. Like they don't feel like sick and nauseous anymore because they just take so little, and brings back joy to life. So it's like these are like insane properties, right? Like and completely paradigm shifting. Like my sense is like as soon as we start taking seriously anti-tolerance drugs as a field, as a subject of study with millions of dollars going into that research, we're gonna find huge like novel therapeutic applications. And in the future, I'm pretty sure pain relievers will be non-neurotoxic, non-addictive, be super effective, and not cause tolerance. It's just gonna be a completely different world. Anyway, just to give you a taste of my interests and what I've been working on this year.
Yeah. Across the different sort of fields that you're involved with, of like philosophy of mind and neuroscience and even technology, like how have the contributions of QRI and kind of the questions and the research, how have they been received by sort of like existing academia or existing neuroscience or philosophy scholars or things like that?
It's a great question. I would probably, reactions are like mixed. So my experience is that pretty much anybody I have an extended conversation with comes out of the conversation thinking that I am sane, that I know what I'm talking about, and that there's probably something to what I'm researching. That is like the overwhelming sense that I get. Even people who started like really skeptical. So, but of course I'm kind of bottlenecked by that, right? Like if I have to overcome the, you know, maybe first impressions in order to get like that conversation with somebody, and it doesn't necessarily scale. So absent of that, I would say reactions are very mixed. First of all, there is a strong kind of prejudice from like, okay, this is like a research institute outside of academia. So yeah, definitely academic philosophers and neuroscientists, you know, straight out of the gate, they tend to write us off, which doesn't bother me too much. It's kind of expected. I would say within effective altruism, pretty much everybody who is interested in psychedelics tends to have like a really good opinion of us, mostly because we can actually describe and put into words things that they have experienced that, yeah, nobody else is able to articulate. So that probably is kind of like one of the entry points that like, hey, like, okay, we probably know what we're talking about because we can actually articulate something that people thought was like beyond words. So that is probably a big entry point, and kind of like, you know, Bayesian probability is like, okay, like if they know what they're talking about when it comes to psychedelics, probably they know a little bit of what they're talking about when it comes to suffering or, you know, philosophy of mind or things like that. That said, we've had like really low success when it comes to effective altruist gatekeepers and people who are kind of like more sold by the metaphysics of less wrong, which are like essentially functionalist. This is kind of like functionalist, Dennettian, eliminativism. I don't know if these words ring a bell, but
What is functionalism? You've mentioned that a few times. I'm not sure what it is.
Yeah, functionalism is the claim that consciousness, the proper way to analyze consciousness is at the algorithmic level. So by and large, a functionalist will say that a digital computer, if properly programmed, will be conscious, just as you and I. That consciousness is at the level of abstract information processing and instantiating algorithms, rather than implementation level or behavior. I mean, it's a step up from behaviorism, where like they used to think like, okay, it's only behavior that matters for consciousness. Clearly, that's not the case. There's many reasons why. But nowadays, both in neuroscience and in the intelligentsia, you know, the cognitive elite, the typical mindset is functionalism. Essentially, is like what matters is the set of information processing algorithms that are going on in a system. It doesn't matter if it's a computer, if it's a brain, if it's a Turing machine, or like an ant hill. If it has the right set of information processing, it will be conscious. It is pretty load-bearing. I mean, for how people approach the problem of AI, how people approach ethics, and even like, for example, for the hopes that people have for mind uploading, that like functionalism gives you a really strong hope that maybe within our lifetime, you might be able to upload your consciousness to a supercomputer or something like that. So, the work of QRI is a little bit like a bucket of ice water when it comes to those fantasies and speculations, because it's like, yeah, probably you can't upload your consciousness to a digital computer. That said, and I completely embrace this, I will say that for me, when somebody says, you know, you can't upload consciousness, that actually is a hint that they haven't thought very much about consciousness. They're like, my sense is that most smart, introspective, well-read individuals, for good reasons, will conclude that functionalism is true. It's just that QRI is taking several steps further, which is, of course, hard to believe. Like, you have to actually dig into the arguments to see why.
How would you describe in brief what the sort of opposing philosophy that QRI holds that's not functionalism?
Yeah, there's several ways to tackle these. But probably the most straightforward is to deeply introspect and consider the role of binding. Basically, these like very strange and mysterious property that even though your brain is spatially distributed and made of hundreds of billions or 100 billion neurons, it's still, all of that activity still contributes to a unified moment of experience. That is very puzzling. It's a very, very strange thing. It's like, where, what kind of principle could make this and this and this and this atom be part of the same experience, but not other arbitrary clusters? And I mean, the typical answer is, oh, well, information processing implicitly has a certain cohesiveness to it. But if you actually go deep in that route, you will realize there is no way of formulating information processing in such a way that it has this property that's called frame invariance. In a sense, there's no way of describing a system's information processing that will look the same independently of how you look at it, what frame of reference you have. But there are other properties of physical systems that are frame invariant, which is one of the main reasons why we think consciousness actually maps on to physical states as opposed to computational states. And there's like eight or so different arguments I could present, subtly different and nuanced, but the binding problem is my go-to as like maybe the most salient.
Is there like a parallel label for the philosophy that you're putting forth that's like not functionalism but exism or something like that?
Yeah. It's gonna come out as like it's a string of words, because it's the intersection of several philosophies. So a very, very close one is dual aspect monism. Is this idea that, hey, reality is made of just one thing, and that one thing from a certain angle looks like physical systems, from a different angle looks like consciousness. But if you dive kind of like more deeply in a more technical fashion, the full string is going to be non-materialist physicalism, with topological segmentation for binding. So it's a mouthful, but that would be the philosophy.
And tell me about non-materialist physicalism, what that means.
Yeah, it sounds like a contradiction in terms, but physicalism, what it says is that the behavior of the universe is fully described by the laws of physics or future physics, you know, whatever bridges quantum mechanics and relativity, we don't know, but the standard model is really close. So we can just say, like, you know, approximately the standard model of physics is correct in that it fully captures the behavior of the universe. You know, as Kant famously pointed out, you can't really know the intrinsic nature of the physical, like, just because you know an electron behaves in such and such a way, in such and such context, you still don't know what an electron is fundamentally. So there is this further question, as Stephen Hawking puts it, what breathes fire into the equations of physics? And our claim is that that's qualia, that actually the substrate of reality is qualia, is the intrinsic nature of the physical. So it is actually not materialist, because materialism is the claim that there is only one thing, and that is matter. And by the way, matter is insentient. Like, matter on its own has no consciousness, it's non-conscious. And so materialism has, as a consequence, you know, the hard problem. It's like, oh, how can form and structure give rise to consciousness? It's actually a conceptually insolvable problem. It doesn't have a possible solution. But with idealism and this non-materialist physicalism, you postulate, well, no, actually, the fields of physics are actually fields of consciousness. And what your experience turns out to be is actually a pocket of the fields of physics. We are a tiny region of those fields. So in a strange sense, being and consciousness are actually the same thing. Like, consciousness is just the flavor of existence. It's not a special additional different thing. It's actually what existence feels like from the inside. But it entails, in a very strange way, that yes, the thing are actually made of consciousness is just they're not minds. We would say something that, like, okay, the pen in here, it is made of the fields of physics, but it doesn't bind, so it's actually made of mind dust. This is like made of a ton of specks of experience. Whereas the brain provides the physical conditions for binding, where actually a lot of tiny specks unify into a unified whole.
It's been some time since I've read about this sort of thing, but it's reminding me of something. The term panpsychism, is that related to that at all, or distinguished from that? Or
it's very related. We could say, like, our work is a detailed, more technical version of panpsychism with added structure. Yeah,
sure. Great. Okay. I think I'm following that. That's helpful. Thank you. What would you say the role of psychedelics is in the research that you all are doing? Like, I'm kind of imagining from what you've said that it is like something like a, oh, like you know, before Maxwell, there was Faraday, and I forget the exact specifics, but like, oh, these are specific experiments that point to some really interesting phenomena that we want to investigate. Is it sort of similar to that with psychedelics?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, I forget, I think it's like the fourth equation of Maxwell, like, could only be derived when you had like a particular weird setup with cables where you had like a capacitor that had a gap in space. And then, like, that showed that, like, actually there could be like electric field transfer in space. It didn't require the wires. So, I mean, like, playing with exotic configurations allows you to essentially test the corner cases of your theory. Maybe as a broader metaphor, I would say it would be very disingenuous to imagine that you can derive, you know, modern physics by just looking at behavior at room temperature. You even require like at least 100 degrees Celsius to start seeing like water evaporate, right? Mm. And like, if you've never seen water evaporate, that's like, oh my, like this is completely new. Like it's gonna break your model of reality. And or like water becoming, crystalline and like ice. Not to speak of things like superfluid helium or plasma and like all of these weird things. Basically psychedelics are ways of, very much like metaphorically modulating the temperature parameter of experience.
Mm.
And exotic things happen that are non-trivial. They are really important, extremely significant, and without which I don't think we would have been able to actually infer so much about consciousness. The same with meditation, but they both have influenced our models quite a bit, but I would say psychedelics more because of the reliability and the ease by which these experiences are replicated across people. And also diversity. I mean, there's like probably a wider variety of like exotic experiences accessible with, you know, whatever state you are plus psychedelics, as opposed to, you know, whatever state you are, even if it's meditation driven. That said, you know, I've been informed by people like Daniel Ingram that even the weird things you experience on DMT can be achieved on like, you know, a fire casino retreat or something like that. So maybe meditation is enough. I don't think so. I think a lot of the, you know, plasma consciousness and things like that, yeah, you probably require psychedelics to induce.
What do you mean by plasma consciousness?
It's kind of like on the metaphor of like you need a torch to bring water up to like boiling point, but then you need like, you know, you need like something more powerful to bring it to plasma. And likewise, like maybe on meditation, you can get consciousness to liquefy, but maybe not, you can't plasmify it. But with 5-MeO DMT, you can. So
is the equivalent there, like that you're talking about from the physical state, something like awakening or enlightenment or something like that?
Maybe, yeah. Mm-hmm. There's difference in that awakening is kind of like a trait change as opposed to like a state change. I mean, obviously, I'm sure that's a big conversation in your circles. We definitely at QRI like consider awakening and things like fourth path and things like that as like more special than just like states of consciousness. But yeah, I mean, roughly speaking, things such as like centerless consciousness, that's like similar to plasma consciousness. It's like a very exotic state that not accessible by most humans.
What are the kinds of things that you're pointing to that are not covered by awakening or enlightenment?
Let's say, for example, exotic phenomenal time would be one. So I have this article called The Pseudo-Time Arrow that presents the case that the feeling of time passing can be dissociated from physical time, which, I mean, the conversation about this tends to be pretty shallow. I mean, a lot of people say if you're having fun, time runs faster. If you're suffering, time runs slower, something like that, you know, time dilation. But that's really just scratching the surface on like time alterations. There's like way more exotic things. I will say that like meditation and awakening can produce this effect we called moments of eternity, where it seems that you step outside time and your experience doesn't have a flow of time. Like one example might be like cessations, where like time stops, everything, it just crystallizes. There's, in some sense, like that would be a moment of eternity, and psychedelics can produce moments of eternity, but psychedelics can also produce weirder stuff, like there's this thing we called time branching, reported on like LSD and DMT. To give you an example of this, is like you are hanging out with your friends, tripping, and one of your friends like stands up and like looks like he's going to the bathroom, but then like midway through, he bifurcates and like one version of him goes to the bathroom and another goes to the kitchen. And then like another one bifurcates as your friend makes decisions. And then you're seeing these like fractalization of like possibilities, and you don't know in what branch you are or if you're in the superposition between them. I'm not sure that happens on meditation. I think like that's maybe a psychedelic specific effect, and it's not like helpful for like advancing your personal development, but it is helpful for understanding like the state space of consciousness and just how weird consciousness is.
Fascinating, fascinating. Yeah, there's a lot I'd love to return to there, but one question I want to make sure to ask about this is like, to what extent are the forms of research that you're doing across the different fields like falsifiable?
Yeah, I mean, like that is one of our claims is that in philosophy of mind, you see, the stacks and stacks of papers, but how many are actually making precise empirically testable predictions? It really comes down to, very
Very
few.
few. Yes.
So yeah, I mean, a lot of what we do aims to essentially be pointed towards things that can be ultimately falsified. And we also discuss the experiments to falsify it. So just as an example, in the early years, this must be like 2016 or so, precisely on the time branching effect. Okay, there's like two interpretations. One of them is it's all in your mind, this is a hallucination, like you're maybe overlaying your predictions, and or maybe that your garbage collector is kind of malfunctioning, so your predictions are not removed. So you kind of like get this branching as a consequence. You render what you predicted as if it actually happened. It's one interpretation. The other interpretation is like you're kind of playing with the quantum mechanics of the multiverse and you're actually experiencing the alternatives. Extremely low probability. I never took that possibility seriously. It's just, a wacky possibility, but hey, when you have that experience, it feels like that's what's happening. Like it feels you broke reality and like that's what's going on. So most people would leave it at that. What I did was like run the extra mile and show, hey guys, we can actually test if this is like breaking the universe or if it's just a hallucination. And I came up with a test and I actually conducted it. So the way to test this is a psychology experiment where what you do is you have three dots in the screen moving at a constant speed downwards, but their horizontal movement is random. So it's kind of a Brownian motion in the horizontal axis. And the randomness of that motion for two out of those three dots was predetermined at the beginning of the experiment. So it's like fixed. You don't know what it's going to be, but it's fixed. Whereas the randomness of the third is actually derived from a live quantum randomness chip that is actually, picking up, like, it's from the double slit experiment. It's like, where is the electron going to fall? That's generating like truly random quantum numbers. And the claim would be if this is actually allowing you to see the branching of the multiverse, two out of those three dots would look like just random two dots, but one of those would start branching because you're seeing the superposition between them. And then if you have these three keys, it's like, okay, which one is the odd one out? And like if you repeat these like 100 times and you get results that are way better than chance, yeah, that means you're actually accessing, you're able to determine which one is the quantum random number
So,
generator.
people watch these dots, and if they're able to say, "Hey, this is the one that's from the quantum data," and they're able to do that reliably, then it's indication that it is the second case of it actually having some correspondence in the way of the nature of reality. And did it produce that result, or?
No. It was perfectly consistent with random chance. So
Interesting. Interesting.
but that's the fun thing, right? It's like I actually coded it up. I actually sent it over to people who had told me, like, hey, if you have an experiment, like, hey, I'm gonna trip anyway. Do you have an experiment for me to do?
So the subjects were on some kind of psychedelic when they did this?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Like, they tried it on LSD, DMT, LSD plus DMT, and 2CB.
Wow.
Yeah.
And those substances reliably produce this branching effect?
No.
Okay.
So that is a limitation there, that like nobody actually reported like strong branching effects.
Huh.
So, I mean, the follow-up to the study would be find somebody who like, yes, every time I take LSD, this happens to me.
Yeah.
And
well, and then even then it'd be tricky because it's just the one person that you found. So
yeah.
Huh.
But with one, okay, an N of one in this case, if they do have like, they run 100 trials and like 90%
they get
it right, it would still be like super strong evidence.
Right. Interesting. Interesting.
But I mean, that's a wacky case, but it's a spirit. Like that, that's a spirit that like, no matter how outlandish your theory may be, there's probably a clever way of testing it.
Mm.
And now our theories of valence, I think, are like much more likely to be real than, you know, this quantum branching. But similarly, like we actually, yeah, tried to test them empirically. And yeah.
Interesting. Interesting. Yeah, you mentioned a couple of terms that I know are pretty critical to the research that you do that I'd like to make sure I understand. Can you start with what qualia means?
Yes. So maybe you remember as a kid, you may have wondered, is the blue that I see the same blue that other people see?
Hmm.
And then you ask that question to your to your parents and they say, stop asking those questions, kid. Like it's very, very amazing how like the wonder about that question like just fades very quickly. But like when you have that wonder, like it's really clear and like, oh my gosh, like there's this huge gap in like my ability to tell what other people are experiencing. By the way, my suspicion is that our experiences of the world are actually somewhat different, like that we don't taste exactly the same, we don't see exactly the same.
Fascinating.
Yeah, I mean, because that diversity actually makes sense from an evolutionary standpoint. Like, it took a while for us to actually have the proper sensor input to qualia mapping. Like, and it's not logically entailed. Like, that's a very important realization here for understanding qualia. That's where people have a lot of this confusion. That like, if you ask them, okay, what is the blueness of blue? And they say silly things like, oh, that's just detecting, you know, what is it, like 400 nanometer wavelengths or something like that. That's just what that feels like from the inside. But that's like trivially false, because there's people with synesthesia. Like they hear sounds and they render that as blue. So like clearly there's not a necessary mapping between sense modality and qualia. So you can actually disentangle them. You can study qualia as something distinct and disambiguated from sensor input. We can go into like paradigms to do that, but yeah, it's essentially a different field, which is why qualia is actually, studying qualia is different than psychology, and it's different than, you know, sociology. It's different than, it's its own field. It doesn't currently exist in academia, but it really should. Qualia essentially, you can define it in the broadest of terms as any quality of experience that can be part of a unified experience. So like, okay, like scent and taste are radically different than like visual sensations, but they both can contribute to the same experience. So that links them as belonging to the same phenomena, as being different facets of the same phenomena. As it turns out, you know, there's a lot of different kinds of qualia. Like color, texture, movement, a lot of weird LSD qualia, a lot of weird concentration qualia, insight qualia. Yeah, there's so many. And we haven't really even begun cataloging them. I think that's going to be essentially a hard science at some point.
Wait, so let me make sure I understand this correctly. So there are different sort of sense modalities or ways that we experience the world. And those can be viewed structurally as like, say, scent or sight or something like that. And qualia would be a specific kind of content in that field, like blue or sadness or any, it depends on what the specific category is, but it's like the content of that structure that forms, and you're saying it's important that it form a whole coherent experience as well.
Yeah, like anything that can be part of an experience
mm-hmm.
is a qualia.
Mm-hmm.
We can define it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And further vocabulary is there is qualia varieties.
Mm.
So there is, for example, color space would be a qualia variety.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's qualia values, which is individual instances. So a shade of blue would be a qualia value.
I see.
And how you can define a qualia variety is that any two quails are part of the same qualia variety if there is a chain of just noticeable differences that connects them. So you can take a shade of blue and slightly modify it and slightly modify it and so on until you get red.
Hmm.
But you cannot do that between blue and you know, like C major. You cannot, or C sharp, right? Like at some point you're going to have something that isn't color and then discontinuity, and then, okay, you're going to have sound. But so they're not part of the same qualia variety.
Hmm. And what are some of the... Yeah, it seems like there's a broad space of varieties there of, like, you know, the traditional sense modalities, but it would also include like the experiences that you have on psychedelics or meditation experiences or things like that. Can you talk more about the different kinds of things that fit into those?
Yeah, totally. There's so many. But just to illustrate, you have equilibrium qualia, which is kind of this... feeling of orientation and the differential geometry of that feeling of orientation. So if you have like a solid equilibrium, it feels like there is a vector that is pointing in one direction in your phenomenal field.
Mm.
And that has a feeling quality to it. Now, that vector, if it is like oscillating in a certain way, you could call that like a variety of equilibrium, maybe a kind of disequilibrium.
Mm.
And if that is like oscillating in a certain strange way, that will give rise to a flavor of nausea, which is actually a flavor of equilibrium. That then gives rise to, you know, gastrointestinal feelings and, you know, might make you throw up or something like that. But the qualia actually starts as a variety of the equilibrium qualia.
Mm.
There's also this disease called loose crystals, like related to like the part of the ear that measures where gravity is.
Mm.
If that gets broken down, that vector is like always oscillating in one way or another. So that would be people with, yeah, kind of exotic or disturbed equilibrium qualia.
Mm.
Another example is proprioception. This is a very strange thing that like is not touch qualia, because actually you can have conflicting proprioception and tactile sensations. You can feel that your arms are like here, but have tactile hallucinations way over here. I mean, that can happen on DMT as an example. You can dissociate proprioception from tactile feelings. It's just that in normal experiences, they are very coupled together. That's actually one important insight, is that we don't realize how many qualia varieties are coupled together in a highly correlated fashion, because our brains are set up to essentially make that correlation very high. But you take something like a dissociative or DMT, or you enter a certain state, and all of a sudden you experience them decoupled. It's like, wow, like these are actually different things. In the space of smell, for example, one of the pieces of insight from studying smells, less so like reading about the research on smell, and more so like actually experimenting with smells myself, that essentially there is two. Smells actually are made of two qualia varieties that are like very coupled together, but they're different things. You have what I call character impact molecules, which is kind of the reverb, is kind of the spatial qualities of smell.
Mm.
And then you have the flavor of smell. like for example, an analogy here is like with a tomato soup, you have like the flavor of tomato, but then you have the creaminess of the soup. And those are different things. And as it
And
turns out,
that's different than, say, like a tomato that actually eating a tomato that has a different like texture but the same taste.
So essentially, like smells, we almost always experience character impact and flavor at once, and so we don't realize they're different things. But I think they're actually just different qualia varieties. Like you can go from sweetness to sourness in smell one step at a time, but you cannot jump from like sweetness to the smell of ambroxan, which is, I mean, for those who don't know, it's probably hard to, but if you smell ambroxan, if you're very lucky to smell ambroxan, you can order it online, but it's a special perfumer's kind of secret ingredient that is kind of is very creamy. It adds creaminess to anything. I actually like as a like this is a bottle just with alcohol and ambroxan that like if you spray it on, anything you smell will smell softer. It's a very strange perceptual hack. It's kind of like a fun party trick I recommend playing with.
And that's, to be clear, that affects the spatial quality of the smell, or the way the sort of smell part.
Yeah, the spatiotemporal, I should have specified. It's sort of like the difference between like a piano key and then like the special synthesizer effects you can add on a piano key. Yeah. So ambroxan is like a synthesizer effect. It's like a reverb or delay type.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, another one I want to make sure to ask you about is neural annealing. Can you
Oh
describe that
yeah.
for me?
So, I mean, we have noted a very strong relationship between how ordered and symmetrical your experience is and how good it feels. And then a question arises is like, well, yeah, but if the universe tends towards entropy, like how can you actually have like a highly ordered experience by, for example, taking a psychedelic, which seems to like heat up your experience and makes things chaotic? The answer is annealing effects. So annealing in metallurgy essentially means when you have like a metal that is like cold worked, like if you heat this quite a bit of times, it's gonna form like tiny indentations, imperfections in the lattice. And as a consequence, it's gonna become brittle. And that is called it's been cold worked. If you wanna make it strong and flexible again, you need to heat it up above its recrystallization temperature and then let it cool down slowly. And it turns out if you do that in the right way with the right cooling schedule, you can actually rearrange the lattice in such a way. And it looks magical, right? It's like you created order by adding disorder. I mean, and the answer physically is like you overcame the energy barrier to go into a lower energy configuration.
So with that second example, you heat up metal and then slowly cool it, and then you can reshape it basically. And so you're talking about sort of analogs to that in the mind.
They're like, I mean, and this is like a pretty strong observation. This is phenomenology. Essentially, one of the areas where I think neuroscience hasn't caught up to like, energy work, for example, is like this, yeah, amazing observation that any kind of like unpleasant quality of experience, like craving or aversion or so on, will have a way in which it manifests in your energy body. I mean, this is one of the reasons why people in EA dismiss us. People talk about energy body,
Well,
take
good thing you're
it
talking to
serious.
me then, friend.
Exactly. So, I mean, and energy body, we just talk about it phenomenologically. Like, okay, it's as real a part of an experience as attention, right? And attention is not a thing, but it's still something you can talk about. It affects your experience very, very much. You can do attention tricks. You can locate your attention here or here, identify with this region. You can identify with the flow of energy. There's so many tricks you can play with attention. Likewise, the energy body. It's not only your tactile sensations, but it's the feeling of the flow of energy in your body. It turns out that any aversive sensation comes with or has a dual relationship with blockages or knots in the energy body. Now, that's a strong claim, but as far as I know it, empirically, subjectively, it seems to hold up. So it is our understanding that a lot of suffering essentially comes down to imperfections and irregularities, discontinuities, divergences, curl, knots in the energy body. And if you heat it up with a psychedelic or meditation, essentially what you can achieve is kind of like in this energized state, there's attractors that are, for example, like whole body resonance. And if you pay your attention to that and try to filter everything else except that kind of like free flowing of body resonance, and then you cool down by paying attention to that, you will anneal that into your sense of self. And all of a sudden, you come out of the experience like really refreshed and like with a way smoother, phenomenal, you know, energy body. And as a consequence, you feel way better. Like it has like pain relief properties, mental health benefits. So that would be the most straightforward example of neural annealing.
I imagine, if I'm understanding correctly, that that would present sort of a unified model of something like both on the one hand, say jhana, and on the other hand, like the seemingly positive effects of psychedelics where, you know, people's trauma are resolved or emotions are healed or things are easier for them. It's like, is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I mean, and it's kind of the, I would say we're at the, what is the way in English? It's at the foot of the heel. Is that the expression? Yeah, the foot of the heel.
Yeah, I got you.
Of a completely new way of like scoring and explaining what went on a psychedelic experience. Like it is widely understood now, thanks to research at Johns Hopkins, Imperial and other places, that having a mystical experience mediates the benefits of psilocybin, right? But when you look at the mystical experience questionnaire, you get things like, you know, fear of ego dissolution and oceanic dissolution, like very abstract concepts, very semantically loaded. But with neural annealing, you can straight up ask a question. Hey, did your visual patterns ever couple together with your bodily sense of self? Or did you experience a geometric smoothing of your energy body during a psychedelic? Or did you experience a concentration of attention into a homogeneous field? Like you can point at like very, very straightforward structural transformations that happened in your experience. And our prediction is that that will actually break down and explain what a mystical experience is. And it will be even more predictive of like positive benefits from a psychedelic than something like the mystical experience questionnaire. And also, go ahead.
So neural annealing gives you a vocabulary to sort of fortify the kinds of questions you would ask people about their subjective experience.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also I think like it operationalizes things like bad trip. Like most people think of bad trips just from the point of view of semantics. It's like, oh, I had this terrible realization.
It sucked.
Sucked.
And so, so you'd be able to, if I'm following correctly, that would might give you the ability to reliably predict which kinds of substances would have which kinds of effects for which kinds of people or something like that?
Potentially. Maybe even more promising. I mean, yes, that is one. Even more promising is how to increase the probability of very healing trips by finely tuning the sensory texture during the trip.
How would you do that?
Yeah, so that, I mean, that gets into the neurotechnology side which is something we dived deep into this year. Hopefully we'll have a presentation about this on our channel soon, and a write-up, which is exploring this thing we'll call LSV, light, sound, vibration. So yeah, basically we experimented with like stroboscopic effects together with sound and body vibration. It's also a fantastic way of testing experientially and for yourself the symmetry theory valence, that like if you put flickering lights that are a discordant frequency with body vibration, it puts you in a wacky kind of unpleasant dissociated state.
So you could reliably induce a bad trip, quote, and therefore like that would lend credence to your theory even though it would suck.
Okay. And I mean, of course, our ideology philosophy is what we call enjoyable therapy.
So you could reliably induce positive trips and it would be good, and that would also corroborate your theory.
So I mean, think about like, I mean, yeah, essentially, so when you have like what we call competing clusters of coherence, when you have like regions of your experiential field that are flickering, vibrating in ways that are incompatible with each other, that is the worst that it feels like. So like a very bad trip quality, for example, is where like you have, let's say you have like a certain way of seeing the world, and like you've been kind of like neglecting evidence for like a new way of seeing the world, and all of a sudden in the trip all of that comes up, and you have this horrible dissonance between your previous worldview and this new emergent worldview, which by the way may not be a good update, right? Like there's delusional worldviews, there are like worldviews that are just discordant with like your sense of self. Like just as an example, is like somebody who isn't trans, you know, on a psychedelic experience may get the strong feeling of like, wait, am I transsexual? Like weird things like that can happen, and I wouldn't necessarily put too much stock in their veracity, like at face value. But like when you have like that strong dissonance of like, well, all of this part of my experience is telling me something, all of this other is telling me something else, they will be flickering at different frequencies, and that will be a very unpleasant state. So, and if you anneal to that, like if you don't resolve it and you cool down, you're gonna feel messed up for a while. And of course, like nowadays, the treatment by psychiatry will be like, well, let's give you some antipsychotics, which actually is the worst thing you can do. Antipsychotics are kind of a just harsh coolers. So they cool down your experience very quickly, which is just going to actually crystallize that dissonance. What you need to do is actually reheat and actually solve the tension, which is obviously very controversial to say, like, yeah, the treatment for a bad trip is to take a psychedelic again and actually resolve it. But that actually seems to be true based on a bunch of interviews.
And what's sort of the equivalent of slow cooling with that model for applied to psychedelics?
One example is, I mean, taking seriously annealing on psychedelics is, yeah, like once you had kind of like a strong change of mindset, realignment in your experience, don't go and socialize and blurt about your experience. Like actually just stay in a, you know, cool, quiet place and meditate and let that sink in for several hours. Like the more you do that, the more you take seriously that process, the more is going to actually like stick with you for a long time. And I mean, I think like in meditation instructions, right, it's like if you had a peak experience on meditation, you probably shouldn't like chit chat with it. Like you should probably just go to sleep or you know, do your own thing.
Psychedelics are the equivalent of heating things up quite a bit, and then you make sure to use the stillness, the silence, the solitude as ways to like slowly cool, integrate whatever comes up when you take the psychedelics. That makes sense.
I mean, could be with company, but would be ideally
a like a gentle setting. That's that makes sense. Okay.
Or if you did MDMA to reforge your marriage or your relationship or something like that, yeah, probably stay cuddling for a while silently. I mean, this generalizes as a framework.
Yes. And what's sort of the territory of the different psychedelics that you all have been researching? Of like you mentioned MDMA just now, 5-MeO, DMT earlier. Like Which ones are you looking at for which effects, that kind of thing?
Yeah, so the most important one from the point of view of valence research, we think is 5-MeO-DMT, because it reliably produces like some of the most transcendent experiences and reliably smooths phenomenal space and time. So essentially does what we call the dissolves internal boundaries and unifies the sense of self and the environment into just one consciousness. A lot of people interpret that as becoming one with everything. It's who knows, right? But it's also consistent with eliminating internal boundaries. So there's kind of like a more, you know, mundane interpretation in a sense. I'm open to like more radical things happening, but yeah, like that's kind of like the prior. Essentially we're really hoping to get fMRI data of like people on 5-MeO-DMT having really good experiences. Because we think like that would be like essentially some of the strongest effect sizes in order to test something like the symmetry theory of valence. Like if the symmetry theory of valence can be tested with brain activity, probably 5-MeO-DMT is going to show up. Second best for that is MDMA, also mostly because of just how reliable, how clearly high valence it is. And yeah, basically we suspect that MDMA shifts your brain's harmonics to a major key signature, essentially a set of resonant modes that are very consonant with each other. And I mean, subjectively, it seems very much to be the case, but how to measure that is obviously still a big puzzle. But that's like a super important for us. So 5-MeO, MDMA, the jhanas as like a non-drug state. Cessations is another very important one, because there's this feeling of like everything is okay, but also nothing is happening. So it's kind of this confluence of, yeah, symmetry and valence. But then there's like other stuff, like for example, for testing actually how Qualia computing happens, basically how Qualia is used for computation. I think like DMT is going to be really key. Like, but that is going to be not so much about neuroimaging. Like, I don't think you can really, I mean, DMT experiences are just so complex. Like just looking at the EEG of DMT doesn't tell you that much. As opposed to 5-MeO-DMT, that because the experience is so simple, it's just pure consciousness or pure space. And there's a lot of coherence in EEG measurements. Like, yeah, that's meaningful, but DMT is just such a chaotic state that I think it's where it's actually much more promising is interviewing really smart people who are paying really close attention to their experience to articulate exactly how the dynamics of energy flow in DMT have a sort of like dual correspondence with information processing, which is a very, I mean, to be frank, it's a very advanced conversation, and like it's probably not for everybody, but I generally think that putting together a team of people like, yeah, you know, von Neumann and Max Tegmark and some like high-end visual artists on a retreat to go and do DMT and catalog exactly everything that you experience and the information processing associated with it. Yeah, that's kind of like breakthrough science that I anticipate will happen.
What do you mean by computation or information processing in this context?
Yeah, so like in some sense, the base effect of DMT is very simple, which is it generates this high frequency metronome. It's kind of like this, people describe it as like the carrier wave or something like that. It's this very high pitch, super strong vibratory phenomena that is shared across sense modalities, like in audio, tactile sensation, visual field, which on the surface is a very simple effect, but actually it gives rise to a lot of incredible complexity as a result. And subjectively, it feels like these waves of energy are being thrown around at a certain frequency in your experience. and they are bouncing off against each other. And by interacting, you're starting to get this complex geometric imagery, and in for higher doses, like exotic consciousness, like plasma consciousness and entities. But it's a constructive process. I mean, like, that's one of the reasons why I suspect it's just a hallucination, is because you can actually see it being constructed in real time if you pay attention to it. It's kind of a fabrication of sorts. And it is all emergent from a very simple energization of a high frequency drive. But the emergent complexity is fabulous. It's incredible diversity of complexity. And cataloging and explaining that process is very non-trivial. I mean, I think I did as best of a job as I could back in 2016 with the article, The Hyperbolic Geometry of DMT Experiences. And it explains a lot, but there's just so much more. Mm. Like, DMT is just so much vaster than even what that article gets at.
Mm.
And I think, like, I mean, obviously continuing to investigate it will probably yield many more insights. But to some extent, I think I need to recruit like other super smart people to actually have these conversations, which is an ongoing process. But like, I don't know, like if we could get like really heavyweights, like people like von Neumann or people like that, to try DMT and talk with us. Yeah, I expect like big breakthroughs in that space.
Interesting. Why would you need highly intelligent people specifically to describe their experiences?
So a lot of these strange things that happen on these states can only really be precisely articulated with the language of higher math. Mm. So things that we can train, maybe not your average Joe, but maybe your, I don't know, average rationalist. I don't know. There's like probably like a level of kind of cognitive development that already gives us a lot. For example, you can train people to tell us what symmetry group arises in their visual field. Turns out there's like 17 different possible symmetrical tessellations, and from what we know from a lot of these reports and investigations, you experience all of them. You can experience mandala, like you can experience like mirror symmetry and glide symmetry and rotational symmetry, all of that. That is at the level that, like, I think most people can contribute. But when it comes to things such as like explaining the genus of the fourth dimensional topological structure that arose emergently in the walls of the DMT waiting room, that is not for everybody. I don't think so. I mean, I could be proven wrong, but and I think like, yeah, the actual complexity and interestingness of the DMT experience is at that level.
Hmm. So part of this, of course, is informed. I've not taken DMT. So you take DMT, you have these experiences that are best described in mathematical language. So you need someone that understands that mathematical language to describe it. Let's say that does happen. What's meaningful about the reports that they give you about like what kinds of shapes arises or things like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's not, I mean, I think like it's all of those are like profound clues. Mm-hmm. So I mean, it's like, yeah, if you look at a piece of metal and you realize that like if you cool it down to like very close to zero Kelvin, it actually expels the magnetic field, and you can know that it's doing that because if you put some magnets, you can show that there is a pattern where the divergence of the field increases. From that, you can derive superconductivity.
Mm.
And that tells you something about the equations of physics that describe the electrons.
Mm.
Like, actually, what is an electron is highly informed by the divergence that comes from the expulsion of the electromagnetic fields in a superconductor. So essentially, I would expect like a von Neumann type to have the DMT experience in this framework and say, yes, the topological genus of the correlations between the walls of the waiting room suggests that this is superconductivity. Mm. So, hey guys, actually, we just showed evidence that electromagnetic theories of consciousness are right, and this is a superconductivity phenomenon. So that is the sort of insight I anticipate will happen.
Okay, gotcha. Something else I want to make sure to ask you about is, you said about this briefly, but you said you've done research or have been interested in jhana as well as cessations and awakening. And I'd be curious to hear like what kind of research you all have done in that territory. And probably you should say as well, what your understanding of those are, for in case someone's not familiar, and then also how those are related. And I can take you through those steps if need be, but yeah, sort of three questions there.
Yeah. I mean, first of all, being completely candid, mm-hmm. I personally don't have access to the jhanas. Mm-hmm. I meditate, I do loving kindness. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of good stuff. I enjoy it, very beneficial. Mm-hmm. But I'm not at that level yet, which I think I'm missing out. I'm hopefully gonna get there sooner or later to be able to, yeah, basically study consciousness in that way as well. Mm-hmm. But we do talk to a lot of people who are mm-hmm. capable of accessing jhanas.
Yes.
And we also talk to people who are like very advanced. Like there's this recent guy called Roger Teasdale. He claims to be a fourth path. Mm. And basically what I think that's what is it, like Tibetan Buddhism that like describes like that as like the various paths is like the falling down of the fetters of like
probably you're thinking of Theravadan Buddhism. Oh, okay. But yeah,
like like ill will and mm-hmm. craving and so on. Mm-hmm. And what's fascinating is that, okay, well, first of all, jhanas, for context, are like these absorption states where you get into like very highly concentrated states of consciousness. I mean, you can probably explain them better than I can. There's this quality of coherence of experience. For example, I believe like second jhana has a lot of like chaos going on in the peripheral attention, but some kind of like solidity at the center of attention. Third jhana flips that. Mm. And I believe like fourth jhana actually equalizes, where like both the peripheral field of attention and the central field of attention, they actually kind of homogenize. And you have like a very, very nice holistic coherence in your field of awareness. Our interpretation of those states are that they're essentially different grades of resonance in the nervous system. And for context, essentially we think that like highly resonant states of consciousness are very hedonically loaded, essentially because they generate consonance or dissonance. They're kind of like transforming your nervous system into a musical instrument. And on psychedelics also, you experience a lot of resonant modes in a way that's consistent with what's called a criticality in physics. Basically you have kind of a long tail of like oh my gosh, now I'm experiencing this crazy vibratory effect, and then it dissipates, and then you experience like small ones and then medium ones, and you have like some very large ones, but a lot of tiny ones as well. In our interpretation, the brain is essentially constantly trying to prevent you from having like high states of resonance. Hmm. Because if it was easy, we would be wireheading. Like essentially, if a cat could just like sit there and enter a jhana easily, you know, it's not going to leave a lot of offspring. It's going to prefer to do that, you know, over like having kids and so on. Or kittens. Jhanas are a way of hacking stable resonant states of the nervous system. And the higher the jhana, essentially the more fine-grained, and the more aspects of the experience are actually in a state of coherence. So something like the eighth jhana, which is neither being nor not being, is actually a state of such complete coherence that all of the information goes away. So there's you can't even represent the concept of nothingness because everything is so coherent. I mean, it's kind of paradoxical that like coherence suggests there's a thingness to the experience because it acts as a one thing. But then from the inside, when you have very high levels of coherence, you have very close to zero information. And that feels like you can't represent anything. But yeah, I mean, we think like that's why jhanas have such a emotional positive feel, is because they're clean resonance.
Yeah, it's a really interesting model. I mean, of course, different people talk about them differently, but yeah, I think it's like a different form of pleasure than, well, that's probably the one thing I'd ask. They're pleasurable, at least in the way that I've experienced or understood them. And it's a different form of pleasure than like food or something like that. It's like, oh, this is weird that this would be pleasurable, but it is pleasurable. So that your model sort of gives a nice account of that.
So that's essentially that's why we like valence as a term more than like pleasure, because people associate pleasure with the standard ways we get pleasure. But we think they're all fundamentally connected. So sometimes we might call about, might talk about exotic valence. So on psychedelics, people describe like, yeah, my visual field had these beautiful fractals, and I don't know why, but they were so cool. And like, okay, there's no evolutionary reason why they would feel so cool. What do you mean? Well, our interpretation is that in those states, essentially you're kind of hacking your visual field to produce a lot of valence. But it's exotic valence. It's not the valence of food. And jhanas would be exotic valence as well.
Yeah. On the sort of like meditation instruction side of things, I think it's useful to talk about them in terms of pleasure, because for one, there's just like a human thing of, if you use poly terms or terms from another language, it scares people off of like, oh, that's foreign or weird. But if you're like, hey, these are pleasurable, these are enjoyable, they're blissful, it like reminds you of why you might want to do it, because it feels really good. But I can see how from a sort of like research perspective, it would be useful to describe it in terms of valence. And how about cessation? How does that fit into the research that you've done, and how does that compare to what we were just discussing?
Yeah, so from my understanding, cessations are moments where consciousness disappears entirely. And I mean, I think like Nirodha Samapati, I believe, would be the big daddy of cessations, where like it's like really strong cessation where for, I don't know, seconds, they're just, you don't exist at all. And well, here's the thing. The moment right before a cessation and right after are described as like incredibly blissful, like really good states. So that fits really well our theory, because essentially perfect symmetry is equivalent with zero information. In a sense, you can describe the information content of something, I mean, in information theory, as what is the minimum number of symmetry breaking operations that you have to do on an object in order to get there. I mean, like an example is like, you know, a perfectly assembled, you know, cube like this has no information, but each, you know, symmetry breaking operation is adding information. So by the time you actually solve the cube, that is an informationless state of consciousness. And it's paradoxical that it would have a perfect valence, that is like complete well-being, but also paradoxically has no consciousness, because it has no information, no phenomenal quality. So how pleasant an experience is going to be how ordered it is, multiplied by its energy, and that's going to require some degree of information content. So it is very strange. It's like the pleasure seems to go towards infinity, but then it actually disappears at the limit, which to my knowledge nobody else can explain except something like the symmetry theory of valence. But yeah, cessations seem to be very healing. That's the reports that we get. They seem to be good for the nervous system. In our framework, you could think of them as injections of negentropy. They're kind of these like huge source of order, and then everything that is disorder in your experience has kind of like a place for you to put it, and you have a lot of affordances to fix your life. And yeah, I mean, that's related to things like peak experiences on psychedelics, except it's maybe kind of like the cleaner, drug-free version of a peak mystical experience.
So the models that you all have give accounts of these kinds of things. Have you done direct research with these kinds of people that have had, say, jhanas or cessation experiences? And if so, what has that research been like?
Yeah, so we have like EEG data from Daniel Ingram. This is his EPRC work, which also recommend, I mean, I don't know if you've had him on the show.
But, no, I haven't. Can you, I know what the acronym stands for, but can you say it for the listener?
Yeah, Emergent Phenomenology Research Consortium. Emergent as in, I guess like spontaneous, unexpected, arising from a process. Phenomenology, that it has to do with like your state of consciousness. Research consortium, like he's trying to kind of make this super cluster of research groups to collaborate and be a bridge between them, to essentially distribute and share data. And in the, I mean, he can speak way better about like the full scope of his project, but he's really ambitious. Essentially, he wants to bring all of this knowledge and understanding to medicine, where like if somebody presents to the doctor with like, hey, I just had like this weird effect and I feel really restless or something, that they will have the tools and questionnaires and authority and credibility to say, you know, that might be dark night of the soul. You may be experiencing reobservation. So like, rather than give you an antipsychotic, let's, you know, connect you to these, I don't know, secular or whatever it may be, yeah, group of people who may help you, you know, with that. Because as it turns out, a lot of people experience profound insight meditation-like stages with tiny amounts of meditation. Like sometimes it happens spontaneously for people, and it's a tragedy that it gets misdiagnosed as all manners of other crazy things, schizophrenia, psychoaffective, so many other things gets misunderstood, or restless legs, akathisia. So that's what he's trying to do. And as part of it, like he has made available to people who collaborate with him, a near imaging data of himself and of, yeah, other people who are doing kind of this self-experimentation with meditation. And yeah, that's one of the projects that we've done with them, is analyzing cessations, tagged cessations in a EEG data set, where with a controller that he hacked, essentially he was, I think, pressing A every time he was having a cessation to like know exactly when it was. Beautiful data set with a lot of like really rich tag data. And yeah, I mean, across the board, what we found there is that you experience, you look, there's a side, I mean, a methodological side note is that unfortunately, when people have cessations, they also blink, and that causes a lot of artifacts in EEG. But what you can do is like compare blinks done outside of meditation with blinks in cessations to kind of subtract the blinking. I'm sure this is going to be criticized to death in the in peer review and so on, but like yeah, I mean, if you kind of like take this method, like, okay, let's subtract the blinking from the cessation, like let's see what's happening there, it seems like there's like states of hypercoherence, that essentially there's kind of coherence across the brain and across the frequencies, so that like, yeah, this looks to be like a very low entropy state of consciousness where everything kind of clicks and aligns for a microsecond.
Fascinating. There's such a broad range of work that you all are doing.
And on such a little personnel and a shoestring budget as well.
Right. Is there anything more that you'd like to say about the different topics that we've covered, or anything you'd like to dive deeper into?
Yeah, I mean, maybe like, I mean, I think like the research on logarithmic scales probably, I mean, it's unpleasant to talk about, but like, hey, come on, like probably people in your circles and people into Buddhism, hopefully they'll have the equanimity to withstand this information, right? But it's, I mean, essentially, yeah, like this idea that like, probably 80% of the world's suffering is concentrated on like particularly egregiously bad states of consciousness. And it seems like so many of them actually have like relatively straightforward solutions. Like what we need is like either somebody who's really wealthy or really well connected, somebody who's like really powerful, to admit this as a problem area, as a paradigm for how to prioritize resources. Essentially, we need kind of like a hedonics or valence aware effective altruism, and somebody like Sam Bankman-Fried or Moscovich, some like super wealthy person who says like, yes, let's take this as a cause area, and essentially push for A, research on Shankar Piedra to get rid of kidney stones, B, DMT vapens to get rid of cluster headaches and migraines, C, research on anti-tolerance drugs to get rid of intense chronic pain. Like these like specific things, I suspect may actually just cut off the amount of suffering in the world by like 80%. And we could do it within a few years if there's the political and sociological and money will to do so. So anyway, probably I'll end it with that, you know, strong manic, but like, hey guys, let's do it. And the problem is that most neurotypicals and most people, when you tell them these, they might say like, oh yeah, this is really terrible. It just doesn't stick. Partly because it's unpleasant to think about, partly because they don't grasp the seriousness, partly because they don't understand the solutions actually work and they actually can scale. People who are not neurotypical may grasp some of that, but then they can traumatize themselves by thinking about this too much. So that's why we need, yeah, very smart, nerdy Buddhists who have the equanimity to say like, yeah, this sucks, but like, it's real and let's work to eliminate it. And who are not so ideologically owned to think, I don't know, things like, well, yes, but Buddhism is the way or something like that. Like, sure. No, but like pragmatically DMT vape pens will actually work just way better. So, yeah.
That's funny. Well, there's a lot of breadcrumbs here that people can follow up on, and maybe someone watching this will be such a person who wants to fund you. That's certainly, I think I'm increasingly realizing that one of the functions of this podcast is just to bring awareness to good people doing good projects of different kinds. And it's nice to hear about what you're doing and learn about it. And I appreciate you explaining it in plain English that I can understand. And hopefully it will be of benefit in the world to have that understanding distributed. So thank you for your time, Andres.
Of course.
Okay. Take care, friend.
It's been wonderful. Take care, friend, as well.